Coming up on Crossfire TV.
This is what's happening in our relationships, our marriages, our children, our family, our churches. That's why people come to church and then it's not good enough and they leave and then they come to church and they're not good and they leave and then they find fault and I find fault with them, they find fault with me, we find fault with each other, and it's just a cycle. That's why marriages end more in divorce than they stay together. Pastor Aaron, and welcome to Crossfire Television. We are so excited about the message series that we're bringing you right now. You can find it online at www.mycrossfire.com. What was meant to defeat you can actually bring you deliverance. I want to encourage you that God is wanting to deliver you out of what you're going through right now. As the enemy has come to steal, kill, and destroy, God has come to bring life, and not just life, but abundant life. And I know that today, the very tactics that he implores to try to destroy you, he can turn it around to bring good. And each one of these seven parts of this series is meant to get you to a place of victory in your life. And so I want to encourage you to not only watch today's message, but go to www.mycrossfire.com and watch all of this series. It's available online, edited and unedited, and you'll be able to watch the entire thing. The next part, part seven, when it comes up, it's about whether or not we have a right to judge or an obligation to judge. What does it mean to judge, not lest ye be judged? And so I really encourage you to listen to this series so we can start living a life above and not beneath, to overcome and not to be tread upon. I know that God's got great things in store, and today this message about double standard is going to rock your life, and in a good way. I also want to invite you to come and be a part of Crossfire Ministries. If you have not currently in a good, solid, Bible-believing church, I encourage you to find one. If you happen to live in the Eugene, Springfield area, we would love to have you here. But if you are in a church, this is your time to stand up, show the love of Christ, show the truth of God, and stand up for what we believe. Stand up as a believer and fight for what the Word of God says, the truth and the promises of God. But if you're not, and you're wavering in your faith, and you're looking for some answers, maybe you don't know anything about God, but you're searching, I want to encourage you to come and participate in one of our Crossfire services or outreaches or feeding programs. There's so many different things that happen here at Crossfire you can get involved in as we reach out with the love and the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you live too far to attend here, I want to encourage you to find a solid Bible-believing church in your area, in your country, where you're watching this, and get connected and start giving. Giving of yourself, giving of you physically, emotionally, spiritually, because as you give, God gives back. And we can fight that double standard that each and every one of us fight, to not be a hypocrite, to actually live out the very best that God has. I want to tell you, often we say, justice for them and grace for me. Justice for you, judgment for you, and mercy for me. I want to tell you, that's not what God is teaching. In fact, in Proverbs 11, something really powerful is said. He's talking about dishonest scales, and he says there's a perfect stone. Today, we're going to talk about that perfect stone, the one that is cut just right, that measures fair. Do you want to be measured fair? I do. because that perfect stone that's on our behalf is Christ Jesus that takes the scales and makes us holy. He's the one that makes us righteous. You'll hear about that today. I hope you enjoy today's message. If you'd like to give financially to Crossfire, it is so needed right now. We could use your financial support, whether it be a small gift or a large gift, whether it be a one-time or maybe every month you'll give a gift to help us continue to bring the gospel and the truth of the gospel to people who need it desperately. And we need your help to do so. This is truly provided first by the sacrifice of Jesus, but also by the ones he sacrificed for, who see the need of the gospel to get to every single person. I encourage you to give selflessly that others might find Jesus in their life and be discipled to live an overcoming life. I hope you enjoy today's message. Today, we're going to talk about having a double standard. So listen carefully, and I'll give you a very quick rundown. We talked about delegitimizing. Have you ever been angry, in conflict, jealous, frustrated, disappointed, and you attack somebody with your words? I know none of you would. But have you ever had it done to you? I got to tell you that I have a tendency to delegitimize someone. I have a tendency to demoralize people, to devalue them, to divide so that I can conquer, to demonize, as we talked about last week, so that I feel like I've made them not human enough that I can disregard them. All of these things in a church are pretty standard operating business. You see, there's only some people who can stay in a marriage for a long time. Not that they couldn't, but that they won't. We're seeing divorce rates, they're out of control. More people divorce than don't divorce today. That's insane. There's a lot of reasons, but overall, if you took these seven things that we're talking about, six so far, all of them would be probably played in, if not most of them, into how we divide. It's also why people can't stay in relationship in a church. What I'm sharing with you today and have been in this series is how we can turn that around for good, because you know, the devil's not all that bright. He is using the same old tricks he's been using for years, 4,000 years plus, 6,000 years. He's been using the same tricks to divide and to hurt people. And it's really, we just then use them on each other. I mean, that's what we do. We end up using them on each other. So we delegitimize. We demoralize. I'm not going to re-preach them. You can go back and watch them if you're watching online or if you're here. We devalue each other and we divide. How do we divide? Well, I got my problem, my issue, my thing, and I go to somebody and I say, hey, I got to tell you what they're doing. I just can't see that that's right. You're dividing. You're not going to the person. Or you do after you've been a long time going to everybody else, your confidants. And then last week we talked about demonizing, where you make someone literally not human because of their actions, and you can get rid of them. No different than abortion. If it's not human, I can dispose of it. If it's human, there's the big debate, isn't it? It's not about a woman's rights. I'm sorry. You don't have to like me. And you can disagree. It's totally great. It's about a human. If you want to dehumanize that, then you can feel okay. If you've had an abortion, you know what? There is forgiveness in the name of Jesus. And he's forgiven me of horrible atrocities. And you know what? He wants to not only take away the fact you did it and forgive you. He wants to take away even the shame. I love that. He died for not only the sin, but the shame. If you're divorced, I'm going to tell you, if you'll honestly repent to the Lord, He'll take away the shame that's associated with that divorce or failure. If you've done it wrong, we have an advocate with the Father, praise the Lord, Jesus Christ, and He wants to take all that away. I'm not here to make you feel bad today, but I want us to not be deceived. I want us to walk in truth, and I want us to walk in freedom, because that is what the kingdom of God is really about. So if you're living under shame, I got to tell you, stop it. Give that thing to God and let Him set you free. He gives you a new life. I want to tell you, new life, new creatures in Christ Jesus. The old is gone, the new has come. Praise the Lord. That's how He wants you to live. But how do we ever get to the place that we can take somebody that used to mean the world to us and never speak to them again? And when we think of them, think horrible things. Well, we do it right here. It's a step process. Delegitimize, demoralize, devalue, divide, demonize, so other people jumps right in. Yep, they are horrible. Yep, they are a bad pastor. They are a bad husband. They are a bad father. They are a bad wife. They are a drug addict. They are an addicted person. They're homeless. What is it? What is it that we use to discredit somebody so we feel better about ourselves? Well, today we're going to talk about when we get angry, when we get upset, when we look at somebody else, when we want to justify our actions. Folks, what do? We operate in a double standard. Because most of the time, if we applied the same standard to the person that we're upset with, that we've already probably done a lot of these things to distance ourselves, to dehumanize, then we offer a double standard, and I'll explain to you why. You say, oh, no, they're really wrong. Oh, then maybe you've forgotten last week. Because we're not supposed to just love those who love us. That's easy. The world does that. We're supposed to love those who hate us, who misuse us, who malign us. So we're going to jump in today, both feet, for just a little bit. Judgment. Judgment for you, grace for me. That's a double standard. Justice for you, and mercy for me, right? Isn't that kind of what it's like? Like, I want you, you know what you did is wrong. There's a price to be paid. But I want mercy. Lord, give me mercy. Give me grace. We should always let God's word be our standard. So what is a double standard? Truth is, there is God's standard, God's word, there's who He is. That is the standard of life that we should live by. If you wonder who is right and who is wrong, well, let me just tell you, live by God's standard. But what is His greatest standard when Jesus was asked, and hopefully we'll get to the actual scripture, what was the greatest standard? What was the thing He said we should do? Love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. Love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. Did He lower the standard, or did Jesus raise a standard? No, see, He raised it. It's actually, if you think, you know, I don't have to do the Old Testament. When Jesus came, He actually raised the standard because He gave us greater ability. Grace is the supernatural enabling power of God. It is the ability to live beyond and greater and above. He didn't lower it. He paid it. And then gave you the ability to be like Him. to be sons and daughters of God. What is the double standard? It is to set a principle, rules that apply differently, usually more rigorously, to one group, people, or circumstance than to another. I think we know what a double standard is. There's one thing for me and one thing for you. And I am justified in my home to act any way I want as soon as I've determined that my wife is wrong. True? I mean, I don't want to get in your house, but I'm going to tell you, I lived enough life to know that once you do something wrong, I get to play the fool. But that's not the way God has it. That is not right. And yet we do that when we're in the flesh or we're angry and upset. If you would turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 6, verse 12. Luke chapter 6, verse 12. I want to talk to you about an unwavering standard. God's word is much higher than the law. Jesus did not come in and lower the standard. He came in and he raised the standard. We need to realize that we cannot live to this place that God has called us to until we are operating in the Holy Spirit or in the grace of God. You cannot do it on your own. You will not be able to read enough self-help books to make this work. You can cover yourself and sleep in self-help books. They are not going to help. Sunday morning is not a self-help. It is a align yourself with God moment. It is, I want to align myself in God's word. I want to weigh my life according to God's word. I want to look more like him every day. Luke 6 is the Sermon on the Mount. It's how most of us know it. And many of us know it because it contains the Beatitudes. This is like the shortened version. Because of time, I'm reading the shortened version. Because I'm not teaching on the whole thing. I really just want to pull out one part that's really important. That being said, if you go to Matthew 5, 6, 6 is where the Lord's Prayer is, and 7, you'll get the whole story on the Sermon on the Mount. If you want to go there, you fly from here to Tel Aviv. You drive from Tel Aviv up to the Sea of Galilee. It's on the Mediterranean Sea side, up towards, guess where? Lebanon. Jerusalem's down here. Up towards Lebanon. These bombs, the Golan Heights are straight across. If you just draw a line from where the Beatitudes were given, you just go across and up, and you've got the Golan Heights, right up to the Sea of Galilee. Hezbollah has been literally launching rockets into that area repeatedly. Not for days, not since Hamas did their stupidity on September 7th. No, they've been doing it nonstop for years. How do I know? Well, I've seen them. I've been there while it's happened. And I've seen and I'm going to be straight with you, hundreds of thousands of shrapnel and bombs that are left after they send them over. Piled and piled and piled. They build art out of them. Now, you want to know a double standard? I'm going to stick primarily to God's word today. So if you're against Israel, then you're against God. But, sorry. You don't have to like their politics, but you better stand with them as a people. We wouldn't be Christians without them. I have to tell you, this happened this week. So I'm dating this message. So how many here heard about the pager bombs? Yeah. Don't make God's people angry. I think that's kind of the key. But the pager bombs. So if you haven't heard about it, Hezbollah is terrorist. They're a terrorist organization. And they were carrying around cell phones. But it didn't take very long, and Israel, they could track all their cell phones. So they decided they would instead go to pagers. Israel then intercepted, they believe, the pagers and made them little bombs that they could set off whenever they wanted without Hezbollah knowing. And then they waited. Well, they've been this way for a while, and they started to malfunction and literally go off. And they knew that it would be discovered what they had done. So they touched them off and blew them up. Now, only Hamas has pagers. It's not like anybody carries a pager anymore, even in other countries. They were doing it so they couldn't be tracked. Well, here's the deal. That sounds pretty horrible. Hezbollah gets on TV and they said, you know, we feel like what Israel did to us constitutes an act of war. Now, let me just explain something to you. They recently, meaning the week before, got a guided missile and shot it towards Tel Aviv, and it landed, and we couldn't shoot it down. Now, let me just tell you, if Mexico or Canada shot one missile into the United States headed for Washington, D.C., I'd say that right there is called an act of war. One. They send them all the time. A couple months ago, they sent as many as they could and tried to overwhelm the IDF. I got to tell you, this is not political. I mean, one, I don't think this is a political issue. It's a spiritual issue. But number two, I just want you to see what you guys act like and what I too often act like. Somebody responds to me acting the fool. Right? They respond because I'm acting stupid. I'm doing something that's evil, ugly, wrong. And they respond to it, and now I can blame them for the conflict. That's called a double standard. I can do horrible things, and then as soon as you respond, I blame you for the conflict. That's what they're doing in Israel, but is that what you're doing in your own home, in your own church? Nobody reached out to me, but you didn't reach out to anyone else. Well, I don't feel like I'm getting what I need out of church. Well, have you been to a small group? No. You're going to get out of it what you put into it. Folks, if you're not kind and reaching out to others, you can't then just turn around and say, well, I'm just not being taken care of, or I'm not being loved. Folks, it's a relationship. You can go to every church in town. And it feels good when you first walk into a relationship and people are like, oh, hey. But a relationship isn't a meeting. That's acquaintance. A relationship is when you show up week after week and you both put effort in. That's a relationship. And anything else is a double standard. Can I just tell you, your marriage is a relationship. It's easier to just get somebody new every year or two. Right? It's all new. It's fun. You don't have to say the same thing, hear the same stories. I know. I remember hearing all about that again. Could you tell me that story for the 50th time? Because I know all about it. Christy and I just jump in together. We tell the stories together to other people so they're not old anymore. We just get to relive them all. The problem is when you stop living, you stop having things to talk about. Keep living. Keep current. Then the old things just reaffirm the new things. But here's the thing. We end up in our lives having these double standards on how we live, and then our expectations are, well, it's not as exciting, it's not as fun. Well, start living according to a standard of God's unwavering standard of His Word. in Luke chapter 6, verse 12, "Now it came to pass in those days that when he went out to a mountain to pray and continued all night to pray to God, that when it was day, he called his disciples to himself, from which he named all 12 disciples." Let's skip down to 17. "And he came down with them," with his disciples, "and stood at a level place with a crowd of his disciples, a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem, and from the sea coast all the way up by the Mediterranean, by Tyre and Sidon." Now, if you looked at a map, those places are in Lebanon now. And then Jerusalem is all the way down in the south. And what he's saying is, these people start traveling from everywhere to hear of Jesus. And he begins to do some amazing things. And it says, as well as those that came needed their diseases healed, and they were tormented of unclean spirits, and they were healed. God began to pray for them and heal them. And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for power went out from him, and he healed them. Now, how many would like to go be in that meeting? Yeah. So wouldn't that be enough right there? For a minute, can we just say, if you went and you were like, "Hey, I went, I saw Jesus, and now he healed me. I got totally healed. I had demons. I'm set free." Wouldn't that be enough? I mean, what more do you need? No, see, because getting free is different than staying free. Did you hear me? Getting free is different than staying free. And so Jesus begins to teach them. Now, this is the condensed version. Again, go to Matthew 5, 6, and 7 to get the expanded version. But Jesus begins to teach them some very important things about how if you live like the Old Testament, it's not going to be enough. I'm going to raise the standard. And he remember what Jesus is doing is he's going to come, live, be an example, die, right? Raise again. But he's not going to stick it out here like that with us. He's going to go to the Father and send his Holy Spirit to reside in you, to give you the grace and the mercy while you live out your life. Then we serve eternity with him. So I say that to say, Jesus wasn't there enough, just I'm going to heal everybody and we're all good. Like sometimes our relationships, here's the thing. Okay, I'm sorry, we had a big old blowout and now we kissed and made up and we're all good now. Are we? Are we all good? Are we really all good? No, God wants to heal us and he wants us to stay healed. And the way you stay healed is you let the kingdom of God come and be established in your life. See, it's all good. How many of them were pretty excited about getting demons set free? It all felt good. That Jesus, pretty awesome. But you know, it says that a whole bunch of them walked away when he began to say, if you're going to continue with me, you've got to eat of my flesh and drink of my blood. That's what communion represents. Oh, wait. This is going to be a sacrifice. This is going to be tough. This is going to be different. It's not just a free-for-all. I just get healed every time. No storms, no problems. It's all going to be good. That's not what Jesus said. In fact, he promised there would be storms. He promised there would be problems. But he also promised he wouldn't leave us or forsake us, and he sent his Holy Spirit to dwell with us so that the standard could actually be raised. And it wasn't do the law. It was be good to people. It wasn't love your neighbor, you know, love your family. It was love your enemy. He raised the standard. Why? How did he do that? Well, Jesus fulfilled the law and the prophets, and now he raised the standard. So listen to what he says, the Beatitudes. Then he lifted up his eyes towards his disciples and said, "Blessed are you poor, for yours is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you shall be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when men hate you and when they exclude you and revile you and cast out your name as evil." I've had that happen. For the Son of Man's sake, Rejoice in the day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward is in heaven. For in like manner their fathers did to the prophets. But woe to the rich. Now listen, I'm going to be very careful here. I'm not going to explain the whole thing. I'm really trying to get somewhere. But he says, woe to you who are rich. Why? Well, because we end up taking that as our reward. Yeah. How many want money to be their your reward? Well, too often we're like, well, I'll take some money. Lottery? Yeah. But here's the problem. I don't want money to be my reward because I watch it destroy families. I don't want money to be my reward because I watch it destroy marriages and character and integrity. Is money good? The love of money is filthy and evil. Money itself is fine. Money itself can bring great things. And it should be a great thing that we can have. But remember how I told you Jesus raised the bar? In the Old Testament, you needed to tithe 10%. But in the New Testament, Jesus raised it to 13.65. No, not really. In the New Testament, Jesus changed it. 10% is simply the concept. And that's how the kingdom or the church and reaching people and reaching the lost functions. And I'm thankful for you that are faithful. But Jesus raised the bar and he said, give it all. He said, give it all. It's not enough to say, I gave 10%, now I'll do whatever I want with my money. No, I've become a son of God. I live in the kingdom. What God does is he provides it all for me, and I take what I have and I put it all in the kingdom. I'm not saying give it all in the offering. That would be a mistake. It's not the right thing. Unless he said that. What Jesus is saying is, it is 100%. You give it all to God. God, you blessed me with a breath. You've blessed me with life. You've blessed me with a job. I give it all to you. I no longer write a check that's mine to my rent, to my house payment. With my money, I don't buy food. It's all his. And if it runs short, then I have to ask, was I a good steward of it? Or is God not providing? But it has to be his. What we like to do is go, oh, well, when I'm doing good, it's mine. And when I'm doing bad, God, what happened? Right? That's how we act. Well, see, can I just say to you that what God is saying, the kingdom of God is about, hey, Lord, I trust you with my whole life. Not I do a few good things, not I believe in you. No, I trust you. I believe to the point of giving you my life like you gave me yours. And so my reward is connected with God. It's all I need and more. Do I have to work? I still have to work. I still have to go. I still have to do what I'm called to do. But my reward is not money, because I have all that I need. God finds and makes a way. I give it all to him. See, it'd be religion and old covenant to come in and say, oh, I tithed and now the rest is mine. No, no, no. I give it all to him. And he watches over me and blesses my life. But some of you are going, well, yeah, that sounds good. See, do you want your reward to be money, or do you want your reward to be things far greater than you can ever buy or pay for? He says, woe to the rich. You've received your reward or consolation. Woe to you who are full. Blessed are those who hunger. For you who mourn and weep, woe to you when men speak well of you, for so did the fathers of the false prophets. But I say to you, here, right now, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who spitefully use you. To him who strikes you on one cheek, offer the other also. Whoa, wait a second. Come on. None of this makes sense. Well, it does in the kingdom of God when you are literally saying, God, I'm going to trust you for that. Somebody strikes me, Lord, you take care of that. And from him who takes your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who asks, and from him who takes away your goods, do not ask them back. And just as you want men to do to you, listen to this, this was the key, you likewise do to them. But if you love those who love you, what credit is it? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is it? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you hope will receive back from them. In other words, I'm going to give you money because you're going to pay it back and maybe some interest. He says, not a big deal. There's no reward in that. Can I just say this? Because if you get nothing out of this except this, if you're going to loan money to somebody, if you're going to loan money to somebody, don't loan more than you're willing to just lose. In fact, don't loan more than you can forgive. Now, what do I mean by that? Let's just say I gave someone here $500. I'm not going to give you $500 unless I can forgive you $500. If I have $500 to give, I'll give it. But can I say this? It might be that I'll give $500, and then when I get repaid that, I'll be able to give $500 to somebody else. And if I got repaid that, I'd be able to give it to somebody else. But I'm not going to give you $500 if I can't pay my bills. Do you know why? Because then I'm going to come after you. And if you don't pay me, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going to delegitimize you. And then I'm going to demoralize you. And then I'm going to devalue you because you're a worthless piece of garbage. And then I'm going to divide. I'm not going to be anything around you whatsoever. And then everyone I know, I'm going to demonize because you stole from me. And I'm going to use a double standard, and I'll show you why. Because God's forgiven me of everything, and I am not going to forgive you of $500. You see? This is what's happening in our relationships, our marriages, our children, our family, our churches. That's why people come to church and then it's not good enough and they leave and then they come to church and they're not good and they leave and then they find fault and I find fault with them, they find fault with me, we find fault with each other, and it's just a cycle. That's why marriages end more in divorce than they stay together. It's pretty simple, the problem, but how do we fix it? How do we fix it? Listen to what he goes on to say. He says, but love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them, hoping for nothing in return. I've loaned money to people, and they come to me, and they go, hey, you know, I owe you that money. Do you? That's awesome. If you got it, pay it back. If not, don't worry about it. We'll figure it out. Should they pay it back? Well, of course, they should. And if I could give it to them, maybe I will. And maybe I'll write it off. But I'm going to tell you, there ain't nothing worth the relationship. I'm not going to delegitimize you. I may not loan you more money unless God tells me to. I'm not going to demoralize you. I'm not going to devalue you. We were in a men's group. Well, I wasn't there. And a guy shows up in a men's group, I don't even remember, and says, hey, here's $40. Is that what it was? Pastor Aaron gave it to me. I wanted to pay it back. It was however long ago. I got my money back. So I gave it away again. Folks, it's just, I can't hold that. In the same way, when somebody wrongs me or speaks evil of me, this week, Somebody who, if I really wanted to dwell on it, I could tell you probably has hurt me and discredited me as a man of God. And it was funny, I forgot all about it. And they did it for a number of years. And I'm sitting there talking to him, and the devil just goes, "Are you kidding?" I mean, literally, it was, I could just hear this flesh rise up all of a sudden. "You're going to have them back to church when they betrayed you?" And I was like, I literally was just smiled because I thought of this message. I said, "Yeah, I am. I don't deserve to be in a pastor of a church. I just don't deserve it. I have not done anything to earn this. This is a gift of God. I love what I do, but I don't deserve it." So it's really easy. I can forgive and hope that we come back into great fellowship, even with people who've despitefully used me. I'm going to tell you right now, there's nobody I can't walk into forgiveness with. And there's nobody I don't want to walk in forgiveness and love with that live on this planet today. No one. Love your enemies and lend and hope nothing in return, for your reward will be great and you will be sons of the Most High. Why does he say you'll be sons? Does that mean that if I do that, I earn it? No. If I do it, I reveal it. In other words, this, when I actually start doing it, pretty soon, I look like a son of God. I look like Jesus. Do I fail? Oh, I trust me, I get letters every week telling me how I failed somewhere. And whatever don't get covered, my wife will make sure to remind me, so we're good. No. For he is kind and unthankful and evil. Listen to this. I gotta jump back. Love those of your enemies, do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the unthankful and the evil. Are you? Therefore, be merciful, just as your Father also is merciful. And then he goes right into this. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Here's what he's saying. He's saying, treat other people, not even so much as treat other people the way you want them to treat you. No, hold the standard of Christ. Treat people the way Christ treats you. See, I'm supposed to be a husband the way Christ is a husband to me. That's a high bar. But it's what I shoot for. You're supposed to be a wife or a husband. You're supposed to love others, even your enemies. Jesus gave his life for his enemies. And what do? Well, we hold the double standard. You'll see it pretty plain here in just a second. In Matthew 7, remember I told you 5, 6, and 7? You can find that whole story. I just want to repeat it again. In 5, 7, 12, it says this, "Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them." And then he says this statement, "For this is the law and the prophets." See, he's saying, listen, everything in the old covenant leads to this. I've fulfilled it. Now I want you not to hate your enemies, but to love them. Do good to them. We're going to go a step above the law. It's going to have to come from the heart, and it's going to have to be real. It's one thing for me to show somebody love that I hate. God's saying, no, no. I want you to change the hate in your heart. But they, and you know what? Here's how you do it. But you. Compared to what God's done, we can't hold a double standard. God, love me, forgive me, I'm so sorry. And then not love, forgive. Can't do it. I'll show you something cool. I'm going to bust through this. Number two, you'll see so fast it'll blow your mind. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 1 says, "Dishonest scales are an abomination to the Lord, but a just weight is a delight. When pride comes, then comes shame. But with the humble is wisdom. The integrity of the upright will guide, but the perversity of the unfaithful will destroy. Listen to this, because this is cool. This is really cool. If you read and you interpret these words in Greek, this is what you get, or next Greek, Hebrew. In Proverbs 11:1, it says this, dishonest scales are an abomination to the Lord. For you to be dishonest in your weights and measurements. So back in the day, they would have a scale, like, you know, the old, not the digital ones, they had old ones, and they would take a rock and they would chip it off until that rock weighed 1 pound, 2 pounds, 10 pounds, right? And then you'd put the 10 pound rock over here and that rock would come in and it would measure out 10 pounds. You'd put barley or grain. Now, if you put a 9 pound, call it 10, write 10 on it, and it's a 9 pounder, or an 11 pounder, you're going to be either in favor or against, right? It would be unfair. This is what it says. Dishonest gain is an abomination to the Lord, but a perfect stone. What is Jesus known as? The rock, the stone. But a perfect stone is his delight. He's saying, listen, I want you to deal with people, not so much just fairly, I want you to deal with people according to the weight of who I am. Whew. Is that beautiful? You weigh God in how you deal with others. See, our ethics in how we deal with people matter. Our ethics. Now, I'm going to tell you, it sounds like, let's just be fair and love, and I'll flit around, and I'll just be this great person, just giving and receiving. No, wait. Next week, we're going to really deal with that. It isn't just forgive everybody of everything and do everything. Yes, I forgive you, but I'm going to tell you something. I also have to speak truth. And I'm going to be honest with you. Nobody likes correction in the day we live. Zero. They not only don't like it, they don't like how it's administered. You told me no. I have not been told no in a long time. Yep. We weigh these things according to God's word. Correction still has to come. If you have conflict with your spouse, you still have to work through it. But it's the way you work through it that matters. Do you see what I'm saying? Here's how we'll end it. Matthew 18:21, I'm going to mainly tell you this story. I think most of you know it. It says, then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Now, he sinned against him. Up to 7 times? And Jesus answered and said, up to 70 times 7. That's a lot. I'm not going to get into it. You've probably heard a lot of great messages on that. I want to take out the double standard part. In verse 23, it says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like. So he's likening. You want to understand the kingdom of heaven? This is what it's like. He says, a king who wanted to settle an account with his servants. There were a guy who owed his master 10,000 talents. So he owes his master 10,000 talents. What that means is it's about 20 years of hard labor. And that was before a 40-hour work week, by the way. They worked from when it got light to when it got dark. And then they took the Sabbath off. They worked 6 days, had the Sabbath off. So this would be that that person owes him more than he can pay. And so the person he owed money to did what they would do. They would send them to a debtor's prison. And because it was so much, he was also going to do the same, basically sold into slavery, not only him, but his children and his wife, possibly together, possibly separate. Well, why? Well, because of this debt that can't be paid. It's just economics. And so the man begged, would you forgive me? And the master forgave him of all of it. Now, we think this story is about forgiveness. This story is about a double standard and forgiveness. So he forgives him completely. Well, the man, as soon as he's forgiven, finds somebody who owes him how many denaries? 100? 100 denaries, which is a day's value of work, or some say 100 days. Well, 20 years, 100 days, or one day. It's almost nothing. And he grabs him by the throat and says, "You will repay me," and has him dealt with to get his money back, sold. When the master who had forgiven him heard this, he realized, I can't forgive that. I can't forgive a man like that. And so he called him in and said, I forgave you, but I can't continue to forgive that if that's how you're going to act. So let me give you kind of my scenario. You see, some of us are cutting out our reward because we're living by a double standard. And the standard isn't towards the people, it's this standard. God has forgiven me of everything, and I hold everyone else to owe me. I ask, hey, can we get some help at the church? We're going to go do this. Well, what do I get out of it? Probably nothing. Whatever you get, God will give you. Well, I really can't commit to taking care of the little children. I mean, what am I going to get out of it? I don't know. Kids' lives changed. I can't help with the kids' church. I can't help with the youth. I mean, come on. What am I getting from this? Kingdom of God. Blessing of God. Well, that's not enough. I got to pay real bills. All right. How about 5 pallets of stuff for the yard sale? And the guy said, what are you doing with it? It ended up becoming 9 pallets. And 3 of them are paper plates and stuff that we give away. And I told him that. He goes, oh, you should sell it. I'm giving you such a good price. Sell it. I said, well, I really am going to give it away. But we're just going to give it away a plate at a time. Stuff's expensive. And he goes, you need to make money. And I said, no, I need souls saved and lives changed. He goes, we got homeless people all over our city. I'm not helping them. I'm helping me and my family. Folks, is that our attitude? It was ugly. I said, I'll tell you what, whether you know it or not, you're helping a bunch of people too, because I stole those things from you and I'm going to give them away. So it's going to be awesome. He just shook his head. If Maverick came to me and he walks in the house and he goes, ugh, my sister, man, I can't stand her. Well, that right there's got my attention, huh? And he goes, yeah, that's blood. I go, what happened? She's in the parking lot. I beat the snot out of her. I just got tired of her. Now, if he did that, he didn't. And I look outside, and there is my daughter in a pool of blood, just barely alive. And I looked at my son, and I just gave him a big hug. Son, I forgive you. You're such a great son. You know, I just love you. Would I be a good father? Because that's what it sounds like all this is about. Let's be people of mercy that we might receive mercy. I tell you, what a powerful thing to realize that we don't receive judgment. We instead receive the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses all of our sins, that we could be a new creature in Christ Jesus, the old being gone and the new coming. If that is something you need, or maybe you prayed with me at the end of this service, or maybe you would like to pray with somebody, call the phone number 541-686-FIRE. That's 541-686-3473. We would love to talk with you, pray with you, help you. If you're struggling not just with a double standard, but maybe you're struggling being a person of mercy. Maybe you're struggling in overcoming. We'd love to talk with you. We'd love to pray with you. But there's nothing as good as just coming and being in a Crossfire live worship service, a live preaching time, a place where you can respond, and there's people right here to pray for you. Come and let's be part of the family. If you live too far to make this trip on a regular basis, plug into a good, solid, Bible-believing church, one who preaches the gospel unashamed. Also, we'd encourage you would you give an offering? If you're not in a church, I encourage you to get in one, but give an offering above and beyond your tithe and help this ministry do something powerful, that we would reach this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ, that people could truly go from being defeated to living in deliverance, that they truly could walk in a place of discipleship and find Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. That's the heartbeat of this ministry. That's the heartbeat of this preacher. And I need your help that we could do this very thing, to take the gospels to the ends of the earth. And your being a part of that is so powerful. Thank you for joining us. Hope that you enjoy this series. I encourage you to go and check out all 7 parts of this current series we're on, as well as all of our messages and all of our teachings and all the ways that you can plug in and begin to grow in your relationship with Christ, grow in your walk with Christ, be challenged. But I got to tell you, it's not just know, it's do. When you know it, we're here to help you know it, but then you got to go do it. And when you do it, it becomes life to you. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week on Crossfire Television, a program that can change your life. And we're going to discuss whether or not we should judge, shouldn't judge, or if we are obligated to judge.
Hi, my name is Marlene.
Hi, I'm Janice.
And I'm Lisa.
And we are Heart of David Ministries. We started this ministry back in 1996 with Cindy Parnell being the leader of it. And the Lord has called us to restart Heart of David Ministries. What we do is we assist the worship team on Sunday mornings in worship. And then we do presentations every once in a while. And we have tambourine and we have banners.
Banners in the Bible was used to rally the troops. That was also, we use it in praise and worship. Also helps to usher in the presence of the Lord with the worship team. And we also have children's banners.
If you would like to join us for this, you can come on October 8th at 6:30, and then we will have practice every Tuesday from there on out at 6:30.
Looking forward to seeing you there.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today and make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon 97477, 541-686-3473, or find us on the web at mycrossfire.com.